We are in the heart of galaxy season, but something is changing. April stands at a bridge between deep space and the glowing plane of our own galaxy. And with the Milky Way returning low on the horizon, it also brings the first major meteor shower of the year. So if you know where to look, it feels like the sky is putting on a show from every layer of the cosmos. I'm Tim, and you're watching Cosmic Captures. The Moon is our closest cosmic neighbor, and it has a huge impact on when we can best capture objects in the night sky. This month, the phases line up like this. The first quarter moon is on April the 5th, full moon on the 13th, last quarter on the 21st, and new moon is on the 27th of April. And to make it easier for you, I've created the Moonlight Astrophotography Planner, also called MAP. It's updated every month on my website with recommendations for broadband and narrowband imaging, so you can pick the best nights for your gear and goals. In the Northern Hemisphere, April marks the quiet return of the Milky Way core. It rises low on the southeastern horizon just before dawn, offering the first real chance of the year to capture wide-angle nightscapes with that familiar galactic glow. It's a narrow window, early mornings, clear skies, and just enough darkness before sunrise. But for many of us, this is when Milky Way season truly begins. In the Southern Hemisphere, the galactic core rises earlier and climbs higher faster. By mid-April, you will see it clearly before midnight, arcing high across the sky and making panoramic compositions much easier. April is perfect for capturing stunning Milky Way arches, but just be ready to trade a little sleep for something unforgettable. And if that wasn't enough, something else is about to light up the sky. This month's meteor shower is called the Lyrids. They peak on the night of April 21st into the early morning of the 22nd. The radian, where the meteors appear to originate, is in the constellation Lyra, rising in the northeast. And the higher it climbs, the more meteors you're likely to catch. Under dark skies, you might see 10 to 50 meteors per hour, though occasional outbursts can boost that number. The Lyrids are best viewed from the Northern Hemisphere, but some may still be visible from the south. But now, let's move on to this month's deep sky targets, starting with a classic that's not just beautiful, but surprisingly accessible. M81, the Whirlpool Galaxy, lies in the constellation Canis Venatici, Latin for the hunting dogs. The name comes from a 17th century star atlas that gave Boötes a pair of celestial companions chasing the Great Bear. This stunning face-on spiral galaxy is famous for its interaction with the smaller companion NGC 5195. Their gravitational dance pulls out tidal bridges and shapes the whirlpool's spiral arms. To capture it well, you will want a field of view between 0.5 to 1 degree, depending on your sensor and telescope. Use LRGB broadband filters or shoot unfiltered with one-shot color cameras under dark skies. Sub-exposures of 3 to 5 minutes per frame will begin to reveal the delicate tidal features. And if your skies are dark enough, you may even catch some background galaxies in the same frame. I have photographed M81 from my backyard using a RedCat 51 and a small planetary camera. Here you will see that image, as well as a close-up version I've processed using telescope live data side by side. If you've never photographed M51 before, this is the month to go for it. It's high in the sky, well positioned, and full of details. If you want to go deeper with a full overview of all of this month's targets, you can download the Cosmic Astrophotography Planner, or CAP, from my website. And if you voted on the name last month, thank you. CAP won by a good margin, and that's what we are going with. CAP is a free monthly reference sheet that includes things that I don't always cover in the video, like target distance, apparent size and magnitude, surface brightness, recommended total integration time, and now even smart telescope suitability. And while you're there, you can also sign up for the newsletter, because this month I'm giving away 10 free one-on-one sessions. This is a rare chance to talk directly with me for a full hour. You can ask me anything, gear, targets, image planning, processing, whatever you're currently stuck on or curious about. I will be choosing the winners later this month from my list of newsletter subscribers. So if you're signed up, you're already entered. All right, back to the night sky. We've covered the whirlpool, and our next target is not just a seasonal classic, but also a record holder. Our highlight of the month is the spectacular M101, the Pinwheel Galaxy. Located about 21 million light years away in the constellation of Ursa Major. It's one of the largest and most detailed phase-on galaxies we can photograph. M101 spans nearly twice the width of the Milky Way and features sprawling spiral arms filled with bright star-forming regions, dust lanes, and faint outer structure that's easy to miss without longer exposures. Its elegant shape isn't perfectly symmetrical, and that's part of what makes it fascinating. The slightly distorted arms are likely the result of a gravitational encounter with a smaller galaxy, NGC 5474, which tugs on M101 and pulls its structure off balance. M101 also holds a cosmic record. It's the galaxy with the highest number of observed supernovae, making it a hotbed for stellar evolution and death. For framing, aim for a field of view of around 1 to 2 degrees, wide enough to capture its extended arms and nearby companions. Use broadband imaging and shoot 3 to 5 minute sub-exposures to reveal its full structure. And if you're imaging with a mono camera or have a dual band filter, try blending in H-alpha data. It adds another dimension to the image, enhancing the galaxy's emission nebulae and active star-forming regions. It's big, beautiful, bursting with details, and once you've captured it, you will understand why it's a favorite among deep sky imagers. And that means that you can also try it with a smart telescope like the C-Star S50. But now to the next target, which is a galaxy with a twist. Literally. M64, the Black Eye Galaxy, in the constellation Coma Berenices, gets its name from the striking dust lane that arcs across the bright nucleus. But it's not just a pretty feature. Astronomers discovered that M64's inner stars rotate in the opposite direction to its outer gas, which is most likely a result of a long-ago galactic merger. M64 is bright and compact, making it ideal for a smaller field of view. Broadband imaging is the way to go, and 3 to 5 minute exposures will bring out both the dark lane and the subtle outer halo. This month is all about galaxies, but if you're craving a nebula, there's something a little different you can try. M81 and M82 had their opposition in February, but are still riding high in the sky. And while you might have imaged them before, there's a hidden challenge here, the Integrated Flux Nebula, or IFN. Faint galactic dust illuminated by the combined starlight of the Milky Way. It's subtle, it's elusive, but it's also kind of a nebula, just not the glowing gas kind we are used to. If you love wide field imaging and deep processing, this could be the most rewarding target of the season. To frame both galaxies and the surrounding dust, aim for a field of view between 1.5 to 3 degrees. Shoot unfiltered or use broadband filters under very dark skies. Another good region for IFN is the area around Polaris. There, I've imaged a random patch of sky just to see what dust would show up. And it turns out, quite a lot. There are rich dusty regions all around the polar sky. But if you want to be more deliberate about it, the M81 and M82 region is one of the best places to start. Also, don't forget, M82, the cigar galaxy, has bright H-alpha starburst regions. Try adding an H-alpha filter to make them stand out even more. Capturing this galaxy pair with IFN is a true test of patience and precision. But when well done, the result is breathtaking. Two distant galaxies suspended behind a faint curtain of starlit dust. But now, let's head south, because the southern hemisphere has its own set of showstoppers this month. Our next target is completely different. NGC 5139, better known as Omega Centauri, is the largest and brightest globular cluster in the sky. It's best visible from the southern hemisphere or low northern latitudes. It contains millions of stars and might even be the remnant of a dwarf galaxy long ago consumed by the Milky Way. In deep wide field images, it's surrounded by wisps of interstellar medium, or ISM, diffuse gas and dust that fills the space between stars in our galaxy. The ISM adds a subtle texture to the frame and reminds us that even the space between stars can be rich with detail. Frame it wide, around 3 to 5 degrees, if you want to capture both the cluster and the surrounding glow. Use broadband filters or shoot unfiltered under dark skies. And keep exposures short, around 1 to 2 minutes per frame, to avoid blowing out the very bright core. This target also works with smart telescopes, especially if you frame it carefully. The next target? We are staying in Centaurus, but this one is the result of a violent cosmic collision and powered by a massive black hole. NGC 5128, also known as Centaurus A, is a giant elliptical galaxy with a thick dust lane slicing through its middle, the result of a long-ago merger with a spiral galaxy. That violent encounter left behind a distorted structure and triggered waves of star formation. It's also one of the strongest radio sources in the sky, powered by a supermassive black hole. Centaurus A is best framed with a field of view around 0.5 to 1 degrees. Broadband imaging works well, and adding a touch of H-alpha can bring out subtle star-forming regions in the dust lane. It's a rewarding target for setups with a medium to narrow field of view, and April is the perfect month to capture this unique galaxy. But now, let's end with something vibrant and shaped by stellar winds. Our final southern hemisphere target is NGC 3576, better known as the Statue of Liberty Nebula, located about 9,000 light-years away in the constellation Carina. Its nickname comes from the distinctive arc and spire-like shapes near its center, which resemble the silhouette of the Statue of Liberty. The region is part of a larger complex of nebulosity in Carina, so it works well both as a focus target or within a larger wide-field composition. To capture it, use a wide field of view around 1 to 2 degrees, depending on how much surrounding details you want to include. This is an ideal target for narrowband imaging, which will bring out the dynamic arcs and sharp internal structures. Go for 3 to 5 minute exposures and consider blending channels for a palette that reveals both contrast and texture. The beauty of this target is that you can get creative with different color palettes. Try SHO, 4X, or your own custom palette. If you're shooting from the southern hemisphere, this is a spectacular nebula for April. Full of motion, shape, and stellar drama. Those were the astrophotography targets for this month. If you want help planning your session, head over to my website. There you will find the Moonlight Astrophotography Planner and the Cosmic Astrophotography Planner, both updated monthly. And while you're there, don't forget to sign up to the newsletter for updates and a chance to win one of 10 free one-on-one sessions with me. And if you're looking for more deep sky targets, check out last month's video. Many of those targets are still in a good position this month. I wish you clear skies, and I'll see you in the next video.